sort of in line with the casual nature of this kind of this kind of evening. So yeah, no, I'm not going to say much. Just thank you very much for coming. We really appreciate it, and I'm really looking forward to hearing about the filmmaking of the film, of your fascinating adventure. And I hope that your second half of your adventure works out well, and the filmmaking and fundraising works out well as well. But
thank you. Thanks for inviting us. Someone has asked to come and do a talk. I thought the most appropriate way of doing the talk was to talk about where we are with the project, as I look at it now. It's been an adventure. It's been two adventures, which has rolled into the second adventure. And where we are now is about making a film about the adventure. And so Martin and I have, over the last couple of years, have been talking about this, because actually it started before I went out to Nepal, and Martin will talk about that. The idea was there, and I wanted to go out back to Nepal to get more of what I had in the first VolBiv I did out there. And I don't know if anyone's aware of that, but basically back in 2019, I was out in Nepal with my daughter. She was going around the world, and I met her out there. She went off to do some volunteering at Annapurna, and I, for the first time ever, got my VolBiv kit out and went on a VolBiv adventure in Nepal. And I think the most exciting bit is when you actually furlough out over the green wall and you go, okay, I'm not coming back now. And you've got everything you need to survive. And it worked quite amazingly. I had a great sort of five day trip, heading east, and came back while the weather was good, and that just, I got back and thought, I don't know, I need to go back and do this again. I think that seems like a long time ago now, so it seems I've done a lot of VolBiv since then. But so I went back, but before I went back, I was talking to Martin about it, and he goes, actually, there's some good footage there. So we had a conversation about this trip, and so we planned making a film before I went out, and Martin will talk about that in a minute. But I thought, as an interim, I'll give you a little taster, which you may have seen this trailer before, but hold on, my second, I'm going to play on one screen now. You hear the music, but not the footage. bag.
Excuse.
Yeah. So I guess my heart basically is watching that again. Yeah, I mean it's that kind of captures the territory. That first climb you see there, the first film light was my first film light. And that view you get of, I was looking at, as I said before, you know, the India, Sepi and Appi and the Himalayan mountains beyond was just absolutely amazing. It was you actually realise at that point it's actually going to work. I could actually do this. And off we went. And the adventure unfolded from there. I wasn't the first though, and so I sort of done my homework on who's sort of done this kind of stuff before. And lots of well known adventure pilots. And the great late John Sylvester was one of the first out there. You know, you look back at the footage now, 1999, I mean, it makes you realise how old I feel. but yeah, he was, and actually you realise how much Nepal's changed as well. So, yeah, they did actually go from Western Nepal across to, I think they get to Pokhara, or they get further, big Pokhara. And then Bob Jones and Rob Whistle, King of the Clouds, which you had some involvement with, didn't you? And he went from Patan, which is again just similar to the place where I took off, I'll show you a map in a minute. But it didn't actually get that far. It was it looks like it did, but
they didn't get that, you didn't get very far. That's one of the connections is that the Bob Drury and Rob Whittle film was made by a guy called Steve Robinson, who had won an award. He was famous for discovering Ellen MacArthur. So he'd made the film about her sailing solo, and he was like the Wunderkind in the BBC of producers. And everybody said, oh, you should try and work for Steve Robinson. Everybody wanted to work for Steve Robinson. And he made that. I was hanging out with Bob Drury and Rob Whittle in the PwC, and they said, hey, we're going to get paid proper money by the BBC to go and do this thing called VolBiv. And do what now? So that would have been like 98. I was sort of hanging out with them a lot. I was spending the summer with them. And there was this massive kind of coincidental relationship. So they went off to film with him. The assistant producer that they took out there became a friend of mine because he was buying footage from the PwC from me for the BBC to use as like archive footage. And then he offered my first ever job in broadcast television was directing my own series, which is Baptism of Fire, because I was supposed to be his assistant, Steve Robinson's assistant. And on the day that I went for my interview, he met me and said, meet me in the car park, and said, I'm going to go and work for Steve Robinson. So it's all yours. So I went to see that it was made by the Top Gear office, and they said, so are you up for directing the whole series? I went, okay, I've never done any directing before in my life. So the first directing I ever did in my life was a series from the BBC. So that's a kind of long hour coincidence. And then years later, I ended up working for Steve Robinson, which I've been trying to do all along, the guy that did the Bob Drury film. And we ended up taking Yolo Williams at the Welsh kind of wildlife presenter out to Nepal to fly with Scott Mason and his vultures, which is where I got my whole love of Nepal from, which is kind of the connection we had. So it all sort of incredible, you know, all about luck and timing, as they say.
Yeah. And then following that, then look, Amarat, who's with Ozone. He's the only one that's really done a proper solo VolBiv, and it was a long one. So Darchula. It was from Western India, all the way across to Kathmandu, so that was an epic one. Still stands as one of the better flights, or better journeys across there. And then that was followed by the very famous 2010 Himalayan Odyssey, which now becomes a bit more familiar in our mindset, I suppose. Seven pilots, but Brad and Eric end up in Sikkim and got arrested at the border. They thought they had permission, and they ended up locked up for a wee while until eventually released, but couldn't fly on. And then 4 years later, Mitch, against and his guys started at Patan. It was quite sad. Theobald, he dropped out quite early, and then Pemmer got killed 60k out from Pokhara at takeoff. I don't know if you know the story here, but they're on the same hill but in different locations. The one thing about Nepal, it's very hard to find takeoffs. In my sort of traveling around in my takeoffs, I don't think there's only two takeoffs I could have shared with another pilot. They are like the size of this here. They're tiny. There's just no clearings. So in different parts of the hill, and something happened with Pemmerek, which a gust of wind, and he was totally killed at that point. And you might have seen the Blush film. Anyone seen that? Have you not seen that? Yeah, the French. Have you not seen that? The guitar. Violin.
Yeah, I've seen that.
Yeah.
He's
carries
violin with
for,
all this kit, but he's got
a
violin with him.
Yeah, so he does 4 months from Tajikistan, whatever it is. Yeah, you've got to watch that.
Yeah.
It's on Amazon. Right. It's, I mean, it's just, he carries a violin with him. You can't play, you make one tune. And I've got the order right here. So we've got 2016, two advanced pilots through from Simicut to Pokhara at the same time as Blush, and he met them. If you've seen the film, they actually met up in sort of Western Nepal. I'll show you where that is in Western Nepal. So they only flew to Pokhara. And then 2017, you've got Bastien and Boxy, again, two advanced pilots. They did 1200K from Ladakh in India, which is like mid-India, to Pokhara. And then Babu, who allegedly did a tandem length in the Nepal trip. But reading between the lines, he got a lot of buses and that sort of stuff. So that's kind of the history of those that have gone before. So as I saw, I didn't really do this sort of research before I went, but as I saw it, I was probably certainly the first Brit to try and do a solo VolBiv across the length of Nepal. So the idea was to go out, get to the western border, fly across Nepal as you do, get to Sikkim, and then go home. A journey of 850k, so it's like, yeah, in terms of distances, if you add up the flights and that sort of thing, it's not very far, but it's you forget you're flying through 4,000 meter mountains. It's a lot of stuff in your way. So we look at a map. So that's the best map I could find to share with you. So my journey, I'll talk you through my journey, and we can then come back to this map later. But I went out in February. I wasn't really up to being current. So I landed in Kathmandu, flew to Pokhara, and spent a couple of days there getting used to the new kit, new harness, and etc. I wanted to make sure it all worked, just to get a little bit of currency on my belt. And then ignoring global warming, I flew then back to Kathmandu. And left some stuff at Pokhara. In Kathmandu, I then sort of collected some more supplies to get on the flight. I have lots of stories about a very famous story about smuggling gas onto a plane in Kathmandu. My idea was to fly from Kathmandu down to Dagadari here by plane. Small flight, small town, airport out of town, and I was going to head north from there. My gas situation was I had two little gas cylinders, and if you've watched the interview where, so I'll say this, but so I arrived in the airport in Kathmandu with two gas cylinders for my for cooking on, and put the bags through, and the guy goes, "You've got gas bottles in there," and I sort of put them inside the inside my pots and stuff. I thought, "There's no way he's seen those." And no, I haven't got gas in there. He goes, "Come around here." So I went round to where he was actually showing me. And on this gas bottle, it says gas on the x-ray. Which you would never known that. So it actually says gas on them. So I couldn't really lie. Anyway, so he went to the stage. I had to go and ask the airlines to ask if I could actually get the gas onto the airline, because it was actually a low level airline. So it wasn't such a big pressurized flight. And in the process of that, I ended up waiting, and I could sort of see the clock ticking. Anyway, I went back to the guy at the desk, and I tried to offer him some money, but he pointed at the camera. Anyway, I said to him that the death state was okay, the manager of the death state was okay, he'd be over shortly to sort out the sort of the clearance of the gas, and he said that's okay. I said, did you want some? He says, I finish in an hour, I'll come find you. Anyway, I got the gas on, I didn't end up paying him, so it was okay. So, so flew from there to Dagadere, at airport outside, then got a small taxi to, which is basically a little taxi rank, a bus stop here, and then travelled north, 6 hours by bus to Daldura, stayed overnight at Daldura, and the maps have changed. So my original plan was to get to Darchula, right on the Indian border. But basically, I got a bus out of Daldura, and actually, I didn't think the bus was going to go there because nothing I'd ever read had said the bus was going to go there. So I was actually getting a place which is Gokuleshwor, which is somewhere around here. As I got to Gokuleshwor, the bus I was actually on was going to go to Darchula, but I got off at Gokuleshwor. But before getting to Gokuleshwor, I came across where I took off. I sort of saw it on the bus I was travelling on. I just thought, wow, that's got to be flyable. And as I got to Gokuleshwor, I realised that actually I need to go back to that mountain range. And interestingly, if you look at the Bob Drury film, they took off at the same place, which I hadn't realised until watching that later. So I started off from a location somewhere here, and my flight path, first day I landed in a small village in here. And then the next 2 days, I managed to get to Champura. The lever broke at Champura. I became very ill in Champura. And I was surrounded by high mountains. So I was sort of kind of trapped in a situation where the weather had changed and the challenges started unfolding from that point. And I'll be sort of brief in my journey through, but we can come back to the map. So from Champura, I travelled down slightly and then traversed through. I flew across into this valley. I was faced with a mountain range here again at over 4,500 meters, which I managed to sort of get onto but not through, so I ended up sort of walking and jeeping through it. And then I was on the edge of the Canali River, and this is one of the charities that I have and I'm supporting here is the Canali River, which starts off, I can't remember the name of the mountain there, in Tibet, the triangular shaped mountain. Yes.
Kamash.
Yeah. So it starts off on the foothills of that, comes through Nepal and then joins the Ganges. And it is the only river that still flows out of Nepal without a dam on it.
But not for much longer.
For not much longer. So there's 3 projects on the cards for damming this river. And it's quite a major river. There's this one here and there's one that runs up between Dagadere, the Karnali. Gandaki River that runs between Dalgiri and the Annapurnas. They're 2 major rivers, valleys. So this was quite a major crossing for me, which I managed to fly over. So I had a couple of days waiting for the conditions to be right. Got across there, got to somewhere about above Dalek. So I was like on the lowest edges of the mountains, but flying at sort of on the edges of the mountains at 4,000 meters. Dalek, by foot, by plane, by paraglider, by bus, I eventually got to Muzikot. Really beautiful place to fly, amazing fly. But then I was trapped again by this range of mountains coming out of the it actually is marked on this map, there's a road which runs out south of a national park. And I managed to clear the pass there eventually, but by foot. And then from there, got to Bandung, and then Bandung got to back Pokhara, and COVID was hitting. And so it's a fair track across a fair chunk of the country. And I did have the figures on me, but I flew about 70%. And the rest of it, I walked and got a jeep and that sort of thing. So it was a fair old adventure we had in the air and then on the ground. I think that was one of the big things I took from this was how much adventure I had on the ground. To actually just fly the mountains would have been great and beautiful, but actually it was also a big part of the whole community. But yeah, so talking back to the film, many challenges. And we sort of had many chats, Martin and I, before setting off on how to do it, what to do, and what cameras and that sort of thing. I'll let Martin talk in a minute, but these are my takeaways really, is you've always got to be filming. It's, and I think it did work most of the time.
We did quite a bit of training, didn't we, before you went. So I saw Tosh's 2019 footage. I went, oh, okay, because this is going to insult probably half the people in this room, but I look at the stuff that people put on Facebook and what have you, and it's the same old thing. It's a shot of your toes, and it's the same ridge for an hour and a half going up and down. Look at this, it's amazing. An hour and a half footage of my feet with a hill behind it. It's like, nobody in the world wants to see that other than another paraglider that's probably flown that hill. That's the only people in your niche audiences are like tiny. And then I saw Tosh's footage from 2019. I went, oh wow, this guy gets it. He's telling the story. He's,
apart from the fact that we've got a picture up here.
Well, it's kind of makes
somebody else.
It's slightly epic, so it sort of works. So he did a presentation, I think it happened, you did a presentation to Southeast Wales of your 2019 film, and I know him well anyway, but I came up to him after and said, mate, you know, you kind of got this, I reckon, if you're going back, and then he ended his talk by saying, I'm going back out there in 2020, and I said, well, I reckon we could do something clever with this. So we agreed, two things happened. One is we would do a pre-match, as I always call it, a pre-match interview, because we've got to set the story up, and you can't do that after the event, you can't go back. So we said, whatever happens, even if you just get there and it rains all the time you're there, we come to the house and we'll, and that was just the beginning of lockdown, wasn't it?
It was
just
all kind of really, it was actually, looking at the footage, it was actually the day before I went out.
Yeah, yeah. So he came to the house and I just filmed him and just asked him what he was going to do. But before that, we'd spent some time, and Tosh is good at sort of writing lists and stuff, of going through the essentials of what you need to get when you're filming. You know, we have certain phrases in the industry like cutaways. You can't edit from the same shot to the same shot. So a shot of green hills with blue sky on it will never cut with another, doesn't matter how different the green hills are, blue sky, it's still green hills to blue sky. So have a shot of your picking your nose, doesn't matter what it is, but you put that in between. So just look up at the wing, look at the carabiner, anything, but you can't edit from the same shot to the same shot. So we went through that, and then we went through the setting up of the dreaded GoPros, which for all that, they are the most amazing bit of kit. People in the film world can't believe that they're so cheap, and we all kept really infuriated when we were on Telegram. People said, oh, they're so expensive, you can get us a much cheaper option. You go, my God, this Hollywood quality film, and it cost you £300. And when we did that stuff with Bob Drury Rob Whittle, the camera stuff they took out was £3,000, and it worked 10% of the time on a good day. £3,000, and they had one each, and you got back and you went, so how much didn't we get? Okay, you go, oh, right, we got 3%, excellent, what a good day. The GoPro, you get 100% of what you're doing, and it only costs £300. You know, I thought you were actually bell ringing.
That's Monday.
So, but there are some common mistakes that people make with GoPros that have to be overcome. And I thought, well, Tosh just kind of got this. So we went through how it should be set up, and just this little menu of, I think you wrote the list down, didn't you? Of each place you go to, do this, and a little menu of shots, which means that, and I didn't think it was going to be me. I don't know what I thought, but I thought, when you get back, this will be editable. And the original idea was just going to be a little YouTube video of his trip. I'm kind of leaping ahead of it, but when he got back and I saw the footage, initially I was whizzing through to tick off all these lists. And unfortunately, one of the epic flights, the camera head, and I know this from personal experience with GoPros, you take off and with all the will in the world, you can have set the camera up perfectly, but it gets smashed around and the settings get changed.
That classic GoPro thing, you pressed it, it's on time lapse. It's like, so your perfect flight is like,
yeah, so it got the entire flight in 10 seconds. And he's like, okay, is there any way you could fix that? Can you not? No, I have to generate about 25 million frames, which don't exist, to make that work. So But that is just the nature of the GoPro. So I mean, at my level, what you do is you have to keep taking the camera off and looking at it and making sure that it's doing what you want it to be doing. But I still thought Tosh has got this and it's a really interesting idea. What I had no idea was going to happen was that he would get so exhausted and so ill and fatigued that he would lose all self-consciousness and just spill his guts out to the camera, which is what we in the business call TV gold. That's what they're trying to do on Saturday Night. That's what they're trying to do on Dancing on Ice. They just want you to break down in tears. Go, I just want to win this. I don't care. And I love my mother. That's all we ever want. So I was with him through the footage and going, Jesus, where's all the bloody flying footage? And then I just stopped and went, okay, that hasn't happened. And I sort of backed off, didn't I? And said, oh, maybe it didn't work. And then I just started going, oh, well, we'll give it a go. And I started looking through the video diary stuff. And I went, oh, hang on a minute. And then, again, I'm jumping ahead a bit, but the attrition that happened to Tosh is very visual, which is great. So he starts off looking all plump-faced and pink and lovely, and then he ends up looking like, oh my God, I don't know we're going to make it, which is like, wow, this is great.
Actually, the rule of all the things that we agreed on was we're capturing the low moments. So I'm capturing those low moments. I'm capturing the sort of the illness. I'm capturing the attrition. So actually, I'm glad I did it because actually that's what's
yeah, that really makes fun. The film. It's a really, really difficult thing to do. I mean, I do it for a living, and it's still that you just don't. The last thing on your mind is I just want a comfortable bed. I just need to find a clean loo. I just want something to eat, and you go yeah, film that. And I've been on documentary shoots where much more less empathetic producers and directors than me are going, get a shot of him now. No, he's really, really fucked off now. I can't go in there. And you go, oh no, come on, mate, bloke's absolutely exhausted. Yeah, great, that's what we want. And he's going, oh mate, just put the camera here. No, in his face, push him until he breaks down. And you know. So I said that to Tosha, that's the gold dust. And of course, the last thing on earth you want to do when you've got the trots, you haven't eaten for 3 days, and you're walking up a steep hill, is get the bloody camera out and go, I've got the trots, I'm walking up the hill and I feel really rubbish. You just want to get it over and done with and go home and go to bed. So the amazing thing was he did it. He just kept that, and you kept doing it as well. It was just like one or two is good, but to lay yourself bare like that and have the energy and the discipline to keep doing it is quite unusual.
Yeah, so in terms of all that, then it was the always, it was the low moments, and it was capturing the story. So it actually, it wasn't just about the flying. It was every time I landed, it was, you know, camera, every sort of person I met, every sort of bit. It was in it. And actually, I used two cameras. I used a digital SLR and the GoPro, which worked quite well having that combi. And the data card safety was probably something I didn't do very well. It's about keeping data cards. I think I'm totally tempted to take a backup, a licensed sort of backup drive. For the weight is an issue, but you're fearful actually of having what you've done the last 2 days on a single little bit of disc. Mm. That's gone. Mm. And I had an issue where some data cards very likely were stolen, which I've never had back, but fortunately we've got around it. But that was a big part of my whole thing, was actually filming it. But at the same time, it was quite enjoyable and it gave it a lot more purpose.
Yeah, and I think you see throughout the course of the film that the early diary entries are quite self-conscious. But after all, the one when you're by the lake, it's like this now. Mm. It's like complete, there's nobody else there, which we all find a bit weird. He's just talking to a little plastic box that's there. But actually, by that point, you were just like, well, are you all sitting comfortably? Well, this is what's happened so far, and it's really, and you're really, really relaxed, and the kind of position's right, and you've thought about the background, all the stuff that is very rare in our industry. And to put that, some bits into context, so data card safety, the company I do a lot of work for on commercials and stuff in London, we always back everything up three times, those three backups never even go in the same vehicle, ever. No matter how difficult it is, we order a taxi for one, motorbike courier for the other one, and then somebody else carries the third one, mm-hmm. so that you know that even if there's a terrorist attack, one copy of what you shot will make it back to the edit suite, which is, that's the kind of industry standard. So to try and impose that on somebody who's on a paraglider in Nepal is quite high, but it's the thing, you know, you've dropped that card, you could have had the most amazing venture in the world, and you know, got to 30 million feet and 600 vultures landed on your head. But if you drop the card, if you take it out the camera, it only goes down the down the drain, that's it. Nobody will ever know. So it's funny little things like that, which in the industry, when going back a step to talking about working with Steve Robinson, I used to get wrong all the time. I was constantly getting shouted at because I was into the art and the drama of it all, but the discipline of it was, that's people who aren't arty do. That's what accountants do, is discipline, not filmmakers. But I learned over the years that actually you have to be uber disciplined, because as I say, you get the greatest shots in the world, but if nobody ever sees them, who cares? So, and then Tosh was very good at that, just relentlessly sticking to the rules, do the footage. And the other thing to bear in mind is 99.9% of what he shot, you're not going
to
see.
Yeah, man, that's so frustrating. Because he's done this effort to save all this data, all these clips, and he doesn't use them.
and that's just a jigsaw puzzle, or what's a better analogy, but the shot is only as useful as the one that goes before and after it. So it's always got to be in a sequence. So, and that's what I now teach at film schools and stuff occasionally, and I say, look, you can have the greatest, absolutely the most amazing shot that's ever been seen by mankind. You'll never see the light of day if it's not a story. A film is 90 minutes long. One 10-second shot, the most epic thing you've ever seen in your life, will never see the light of day if you haven't got the 89 minutes to go with it. And those 89 minutes can be incredibly boring, but if they build up to the point where the Challenger blows up, if you've met all the people that went on the Challenger, and you've seen the journey where they walk to the tower and they get up there, when the thing goes bang, it's going to mean way more than just that one shot. And that's a real discipline, and I took me years to learn. You've just got to get all the boring shit, because you don't know. You have no idea how relevant the boring stuff is until the adventure happens. And that was very true of your stuff, wasn't it? That it all becomes, you say, oh, hang on a minute, you did that thing back there, didn't you? Oh, well, let's backtrack. And to be fair, I'm not an editor, so we have done an awful lot of to-ing and fro-ing with the story. So. But could we get to this point and go, that's amazing. Ah, but that wouldn't have happened if you hadn't done that thing. And that thing is, at the moment, on the cusp of being flawed. So we'll get that back. We'll bin all that epic footage, because this is more epic, and that bit builds you up to why you were here. So it's a very, very different discipline to the just strap a GoPro on your head and fly up and down the mall.
You might worth mentioning your interviews as well with the experts.
Yeah, that went much better than we'd hoped.
Yeah. So yeah, I think that's for you.
Well, so we lucked out a bit. So one of the things I thought about in the credits is we really got to credit Wesley Merch, because he did the podcast and I filmed it for the Southeast Wales Club. And I learned a lot more about the adventure, because Wes is a really, really good interviewer, much better than me. He's very, very good at coaxing the story and personality out of people. So I said, could I just keep the soundtrack? And we actually laid that in as our storyline in the end, because we were going around in circles about where we're going to go. So we just basically took Wes's podcast and laid that in on the edit line as the sound. And then we tried to illustrate it with pictures. And then we realized the bits where Wes was saying, well, for people who don't know about paragliding, this is this, this, and this. We go, well, we can't put that in. So then we thought, well, let's find the experts who can. And we were really fortunate. We got Dr. Matt Wilkes, Jockey Sanderson, and then when I've been out to Nepal, the two times I've been out, then Adam Hill was my go-to. and he's basically the guy that discovered Nepal as a flying site. So he's Mr. Nepal, and we went to see him, and he was just he did a talk for the South East Wales Club, which I think you and I there was three of us, I think, and I was used to be the social secretary for South East Wales, and I got Adam in, and he came all the way from Somerset or whatever. There's about six people there, and he was brilliant. And I went, oh my god, he's a really good talker, which kind of got you inspired. You had a long chat with him afterwards. So then I phoned him up and said, look, can we interview you? And he was great. He's very, very, very good in front of camera. And he explains a lot of the stuff. And I go back a tiny step. So the traditional way that you would make a film like this is you would get somebody who was as good at it as Tosh with the GoPro, but you would also have a camera crew and a helicopter. And you would, at the cost of 20,000 quid a day, and you would maybe find five or six flight points on the flight where you would land and you'd film him going past, and then you'd take off again and go to that. Tosh did this completely on his own. So we didn't have that luxury at all. And so we needed to, stuff that you would just see normally, we needed to be able to explain. And Adam Hill did that really well. I don't know, I need to look, so carry on.
We'll come back to that, because actually the interview is actually, and the whole storyline has been part of making the whole thing into more of an adventure documentary, which I think now is, you know, when you see it, it'll be attractive to everyone, paraglide pilot or non-paraglide pilot, but actually it's a proper adventure story now. Just slide over me. So the as I said before we started talking to Martin, that the interaction of people to me was actually something which you sort of see people say, oh, look, they meet all the people around me and how much interaction I had. I hadn't appreciated the level of interaction I had with the Nepali people. To me, it was just beautiful. The whole village just wants to see you, wants to be with you, wants to hear about you. The first village I landed in, I was the third Westerner there. The two of us had been there, two Americans teaching about God, and I was the third one, and I flew in. So actually, by flying in... Yes, you're right. Well, you say that all the old ladies, apparently, all hid in the houses. They were so scared. You know, it literally was. No idea about paragliding. Yeah, just completely. And I've been trying to get out this valley for ages. I've been flying around every while trying to get this valley. It just didn't work. And it was my first flight. I thought I'm going to land somewhere half sensible, as opposed to sort of trying to sort of top land or something, because it wasn't working. So I just basically flew down to the paddy field, and then that was bang. It was just like the whole village just came storming out. Literally, came storming the road, and as I came into land, obviously I was coming into them. So they're running towards me, and then they're running away from me. I landed in the round. So there's a little montage of a clip here, which hopefully will play on the screen. Yes, that is. Watch the lady with the stick, yeah. All the children, the school children in blue. As you pack away, get closer and closer and closer, so you just lose the space to actually even put your helmet in the bag at the end of the. Yeah, it was the first landing now. Watch this guy at the back down here now. You can see him. So actually, it was as big as my glider. By the time I finished, it was as big as my bag in space. And then you end up being the Pied Piper out of the airfield.
So that's the kind of stuff, when you go through the rushes, in my position, you go, oh god, this is fantastic.
Yeah.
And I don't know what I missed when I was in the loop.
You're talking about the rest of the guys we interviewed.
Yeah, but I'll come back to the good story a little bit. One of the big points that the film is really about is that because, which Adam Hill explains very well in his interview, because Tosh was forced to fly the lowlands, obviously not the lowlands by UK or European standards, but the pre-Himalayas, whatever you call them, then he was interacting. If he'd done the original vision that we both had, was Brad, bizarrely again another coincidence, Brad Sander, when he went off to do that adventure that was on number 5 on that list, I was there when he left. He was in Nepal, and then we had a party to say he's going off to do this thing. And then 3 weeks later, I got pointed at the YouTube video, the famous one of him where he's completely covered in frost and he's at 90 million feet. And he's going, oh, this is really cool. And it's really cold. This is about as expressive as he ever gets. And we just thought that's what we were going to get. We thought, well, now he's really got them there. We've worked out how to keep the cameras warm. And Tosh is going to go into the stratosphere and get all covered in ice, and he's going to hop all the way across Nepal and land on the other side. The weather dictated that wasn't going to happen, so he had to go, I would say, down the front. So that's what it looked like to me. But that meant that he was landing, he'd land on top of the hills where he was flying, on the mountains where he was flying, but a lot of the time he'd land down in the valleys and interact with the people, which is what I wasn't expecting at all. So I was looking through the rushes and going, oh my God, this is amazing. We saw how colourful it, just literally, if that was in a commercial for Nepal, they would put that shot in. So it's all that colour and all that noise and emotion.
Happiness.
And they're incredible people. I mean, I said, how many people here have been to Nepal? They're the happiest people in the world, yeah, really? The poorest, but the happiest, which is, gives us a big kind of philosophical debate right there, because they're just... And they're so generous, they're ridiculously generous with their time and what little they've got.
It's supposed to be happier in Bhutan.
Yeah, well, they're even more cut off from our Western problems. So, and I found it funny, Adam Hill's talk was about that.
Yeah,
you must pay the money, you must go to Bhutan. And everybody should go and do it, because you'll see that there's another way. And now I've lost my thread. Yeah, so the point I was going to make was, as a filmmaker, then you see that stuff and you go, whoa, okay. We were initially disappointed that we didn't get some of the in-air footage. We knew we weren't going to get the air-to-air footage because there wasn't a helicopter there. But then you got this stuff, and you go, well, this is actually, we've all seen the epic shots of people flying through the Alps or the Himalayas, and they Red Bull helicopters getting it all, and it's beautifully lit. It's not telling you much about the world, it's just a pretty picture of a paradise. But then you see these people, and suddenly it becomes a kind of more anthropological investigation. You know, he's in there, and how generous are these people? What will they give up? What will they do? And I was constantly thinking, well, at some point they're obviously going to rob him, and you know, of course, no, they don't. It's important.
I mean, also it makes the film that we're creating more appealing to the wider audience.
Yeah.
Because actually the last thing you want to hear is the various screaming away, although it gets us going. And aerial shots of a paraglider, really. You want to see the bigger picture now.
Yeah. And so to go back to the people we interviewed, so Adam Hill explained that point beautifully, because that's what he did. He met his wife, he discovered Nepal because he was working for the Geographical Society, I think it was, or something. And he was surveying all the water points in Nepal. And he'd just taken up paragliding. And he was getting sick of taking taxis and trying to get jeeps and things. And he went, if I just fly this valley today and land up there, and I can fly to that one tomorrow. And he did, he got paid by the Royal Geographical Society to survey the valleys and the area of the Annapurna bit behind Pokhara. And he kept landing in all the villages, and he experienced all this yonks ago before, and that's when he went, oh my God, this is paragliding paradise. So that's the long story of him. So he was then obviously able to explain this story of how wonderful it is to not necessarily do the Brad Sander thing and go up into the stratosphere, but actually land down in the villages and meet the people and experience that, which is as wonderful and, you know, completely out of our experiences getting up to 25,000 feet that Brad Sanders are. So that was great. So he explained that very, very well. Jockey Sanderson, he was there to explain to a non-paragliding audience what paragliding is. And does how many people here know of Jockey?
Everyone, pretty much. And he does it so colourfully. Yeah, that's
the larger than life character. Yeah. The biggest problem with him is riding the volume levels, because he's just like, wow, oh shit, way louder than I was ready for. And also keeping him in the frame, because he's all hands and the clouds are like this.
Banging the mic.
Calm down, let me move the camera back a bit. And then I'd heard Matt Wilkes again on Wes's podcast, and then I just researched him a bit more, and I think he was on Radio 4 or something, and I thought, wow, he's really, really good. And I was surprised that I didn't know that he'd sort of teamed up with Jockey, so I had written to him separately and said, would you possibly consider helping us? And he was like, yeah, of course. And I'll meet you at Jockey's place. And then we went to meet Jockey, and Jockey and Matt were actually doing one of their first aid courses together. So we just hauled him out in their lunch break and interviewed him. And Matt was very, very, he puts in some contextual information that I don't think you would know. I mean, you might do if you're alpinists or whatever. Well, that was a total, I think it was a revelation to both of us, really, wasn't it?
So he talks about altitude issues, attrition, fatigue, and those sort of things. So actually adds the sort of his expertise into the whole storyline.
The sort of science.
And point to where I've got altitude issue, fatigue.
Well, because we hadn't really thought that through, had we? The sort of 3,000-4,000 feet. I've been to
meters.
Meters, yeah. I've been to what? Three. I don't know. I can never work it backwards. About 11,500 feet anyway in there, and I found it quite tiring. I wouldn't say any more than that, but it was just one day. We just trekked up, camped halfway up, trekked up the next day, and then flew back down again. And then Matt Wilkes was explaining that if you do that over a length of time, it has quite a big effect on your physiology. If you're doing it for 3 weeks, it actually starts to attack your body. That's a significantly lower oxygen level than we're used to. And your body doesn't acclimatise that quickly, so that starts to affect stupid things like your decision making, he was saying, which I had never thought of. So that was actually complete. We didn't prime him for that at all. We just said, can you talk about what Tosh is likely to have gone through? And he came back with all this information. We were going, oh.
It's interesting, because actually it's only really in retrospect that you actually look back and you're thinking, why couldn't I walk that distance? Why was I struggling? You walk as though you're walking in this country. You're sort of going on determination. You need to slow down, because actually you just can't absorb the oxygen quick enough to actually keep that pace up. So you're instantly sort of like dragging yourself down all the time. And then that decision-making thing was quite significant for a lot of the time I was there, because you end up, it came very apparent early on that actually it was the game of chance. I was sort of, this journey is more of a game of chance than it was about a planned event. So although I'd sort of set off and I looked at the map and I go, actually, if I go there, that's a good place. And I was looking at track logs, there's very few out there, trying to decide where I could sort of get to and take off from. But instantly from the first flight I took off, well, I didn't even take off in the first place I wanted to take off from anyway. So everything I planned was out the window. And the one plan I had was to head east. And then it was, The people that you met, how you reacted with them, and where you walked to the next day, and what the weather was doing. There's so many variables in your journey, but your decision making, you're sort of very conscious of the fact that actually, if I decide to walk up that hill, am I making that decision, or should I go up that mountain over there, or should I, should I go down that road? And actually, you're constantly in this mindset of actually thinking, I need to make up my mind here, which way I'm doing, what I'm doing. And actually, it became harder as the journey went on, of actually sort of trying to decide on how what I should be doing next. And you become very aware of the clock ticking, and you're not making the progress you're hoping to because of weather issues. And it was an interesting, I think I didn't really realise until I actually got back on how that rolling the dice and the decision making was such a key element of the whole journey.
And that having lower levels of oxygen actually really quite affects everybody's decision making, and you're not aware of it. It's not Everest base camp. It's not, but actually just that little bit lower oxygen level means that you're not thinking as, and some people become euphoric with low oxygen levels, and we all know where that ends up. And some people become more risk averse and start to question every decision. And that's actually alpinists and Himalayan expeditions, doctors will say, well, that's complete, they're used to it. So the people that go up Everest, or whatever, they're used to seeing this behavioural pattern where people start to become less rational and more either crazy brave or very doubtful of stuff that seems really obvious in this oxygen saturation. And we didn't, and I don't think that occurred to either.
And it was actually a couple of times I was sort of, and you become, you know, I look back now at the first sort of flights I did, I'm thinking, Christ, that's pretty ballsy. And then each day it was pretty ballsy, but actually by the third day, ballsy's normal. So by the time I've actually had 3 weeks of being ballsy's normal, and you've got now into higher altitudes, you actually, your risk taking just gets higher and higher. So you're just looking at a scenario thinking, yeah, I'm gonna take off. It's a bit like an exhale swing, but at my level. and so you end up sort of just pushing the boundaries beyond what I'd ever think I was ever pushing it, looking back at it now, which was.
Yeah, and I think if you're so low, I'm sure most people here have done it, and you've gone to the hill and you're the only one there, especially in the early days. And what would absolutely be a no-brainer, well, let's just go, because the hill's full of people, nobody's taking off, because it's a perfectly mellow midsummer, late morning. The first time you ever get to a hill on your own, that's suddenly not. It's just, why is there nobody else here? All that stuff. So you would think that Tosh would have got that in on steroids, but actually, your way of dealing with the low oxygen levels, you just got braver. It'll be fine. I'll sort it out in the air. So that's kind of interesting. And that book was very good at explaining that people generally fall into one of those two camps when their oxygen levels go down. But you also had low nutrition, because even though you were eating, it was rations you were taking with you, and you've got to carry it. So that's necessarily going to mean you don't want to carry too much weight. So you're going to compromise and eat a bit less than probably you should do. And what was the overall height that you walked the entire
time? Oh, it's ridiculous. Yeah, it is quite amazing.
That's a shame you can't remember that statistic, because it's immense. It's kind of like walking up Mont Blanc four times in a row or something. Of just climbing. So then you look on the stats and you realize actually your calorie intake when you're doing that is 4,000 calories a day, not 1,200 or whatever you think it should be.
I think that might lead me to the next slide. Porters.
Good segue.
So, and this is about the interaction with people as well. And I think for me, it was a no-brainer. Absolutely no-brainer. Because actually, these guys, just guys in the village who might live on the mountain, might be visiting the village below, or vice versa. And there's just so many advantages of it. You're clearly much faster. And I think I was talking upstairs about there was one scenario that I was walking. This boy, he was had been staying with his family, and this boy knew his family, and he was going back up to his family in the same mountain. And he was like 14, 15, and they had a conversation. He said, "We'll carry your bag for you." I'm like, great. 14, 15 year old boy with my bag. I had no bag. I could hardly keep up with this guy. He was just off, storming up the hill. And at the end, and he was basically just been down. How far down was it? It was like 1,200 meters down to the village to get some milk. And he was back up to, and it was just, anyway, he didn't want any money. So that was, how it was. And then these other guys, they were sort of basically doing an hourly rate. So I basically paid them an hourly wage. It wasn't much. It was about £5 or £6 an hour. But that was good money, and I was quite happy to pay that into the community. I felt I was giving that back. You end up then talking to them. This guy, that one there, you see how he carries the bag. He doesn't use the shoulder straps. He has a strap that goes on the back of the bag and over his head. That's more comfortable. I met his mum. I saw his auntie. He knew the way. You can quite easily just take a path which is getting taken around the wrong spur of the mountain. So actually you end up getting there quicker, you know, about getting lost. You have a moment where you can be walking up a mountain for 2 or 3 hours. It's you know, you remember that walk, but actually if you're walking with someone and then you've been stopping and talking in very sort of almost a sign language about different things, you remember that walk up so much more. So the whole thing was just, yeah, added to the whole adventure. I had some great guys really doing that, and met their part of their family on the way and everything. So it was again back to this thing where actually by ending up possibly landing low for whatever reason, whether it be for water or just ballsing up on the flight, you had to sort of look at everything as a positive, and thereafter you often had the positive of walking up with someone. So for a few rupees. Has anyone else used porters in Nepal?
I was totally humiliated by, there's a little gang of 3 Nepali women, 5 foot tall,
yeah,
and they carried the weight up, shooting up ahead, yum 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 amongst themselves.
Yeah.
That's just scary.
When we did our set, because we were filming it, so I had the camera kit, so I insisted on carrying that, but I wasn't taking, we did it all on tandems, and it was all organised by Scott Mason's lot out in the lakeside. And I remember one point thinking, God, this is hard work walking. I mean, just walking up and up and up for 2 days, basically. Just a reasonable steepness, not crazy, but just reasonable. But it just ended up the Nelson doing to go down. And I remember one point sort of feeling a bit sorry for myself, and then looking at, we had some proper Sherpas as opposed to porters, because they were our guy in Pokhara was one of the Everest people, so he had the Sherpas, and they're a very distinct shape, sort of Bob Hoskins shape. They're all very wide and very low. And I looked at them, and one of them was in a pair of plimsolls with no laces, which he pushed the backs down on to get his feet into, and the other one was wearing flip-flops. Mm-hmm. I thought, I should really shut up. They can do that in flip-flops, and I'm moaning about the fact that not quite the right temperature, and we should spend more money on our walking shoes because my feet are a bit uncomfortable. Blah blah blah. Blah. Look, I went, no, really, I should shut up.
The only thing I'd say is that I had quite often gets up the hill, and I was, you know, your kid's carried it up. He then sort of says, you're getting food, and you're thinking, I ain't got much food. You know, it's just, so you end up sort of giving food away, and you think that's this one thing. I was like, you know, personally, it was a little bit of that. Why don't you bring some sandwiches with you? it was great.
I get a little funny little anecdote, which is not related to the tour, but it makes me laugh every time. It was on that trip that I did food. So the first camp we stayed at, we're all ravenous by that point. We've been walking for 7 or 8 hours and uphill, and I went off to film the sunset and the camp, as I do, and I came back and went, right, what's the dinner deal? And Scott Mason and the others, it's not great, it's just this nettle soup and it's not very nice. I said, well, what do I do? They said, well, just go and find the porters and just take your bowl and say, look, well, I want some of that nettle soup. Well, it wasn't nettle soup, it was just stinging nettles in boiled water. So just mushy stinging nettles. Okay. Well, that'll have to do, and it tastes like boiled stinging nettles. Great. But I noticed that the porters and the shepherds were all looking at us like we had two heads. And I think, what's the problem? Well, why are they being so weird? And then they bought the kitchen up, and then they're supposed to cook our food. And then we'd all eaten this, and basically we'd all thrown it in a ditch because it was disgusting. They were like, but don't let them see because they've gone to all this trouble. And then they went, so now your dinner's ready, and they brought out the dal and the proper soup and everything else that they'd been cooking for us. The nettles were for them, which they'd gathered because they didn't want to carry extra food, and we'd eaten their food, and we all got screaming trots the next day because we'd all eaten vaguely boiled nettles, and they thought we were completely, it's like, your sister's never going to cope with eating nettles. We've got your chicken soup. What's wrong with it?
I think as the storyline has gone, it's actually been about the sort of challenges that I've had on the way, and yeah, big and small. But I think the 4 main ones that I think I had, this is perhaps going from what I was talking about before, the weather was the big change in the plan. It started off brilliantly and deteriorated cloud base was, and classically it wasn't sort of a high pressure situation yet with the clouds, it was like clouds from, it was fun to see, you can't really see it at the end because of rain falling, but I heard the soundtrack to this pitch, it's actually Oh, Here's Thunder, and I was, for quite half a time, I was flying in a day with any thunderstorms. So you end up in the wake of the morning, it'd be a beautiful clear blue sky, and just totally unstable. So by mid-morning, you were faced with towering clouds, and you know, down gusts and heavy rain later. And there's, you know, a couple of times I'd be on a hill and you'd see where you're gonna go. Early on, 9 o'clock, you're thinking, right, and as soon as it starts working, I'm off. Before it started working, you're in cloud. So it's, you know, a really frustrating time for pushing across the country. And I think that's why it took me 21 days to get to Pokhara.
What time of year was this?
February, March. An interesting look at the flights before, quite a lot of successful ones had been February, March. Some were obviously October, November. I chose February, March really, personally, it was a better time of year for me. I like to be away in February, it's a shit time to be here. Also, it was becoming warmer for me, so I think, yeah, it was. Then we've been out there in October, November.
Yeah.
In Nepal.
Yeah.
And how would you? Yeah.
Beautiful clear sky. It's very.
No, that seems to be the two good times. Obviously, from a filming point of view, I was told by like tourist people and stuff, you either go out October, November, or you do February, March, because those are the two times when you get there. In Pokhara, especially, that's when you get the view of the Annapurna, it's when you get to see the Darchula, and can't see it any other time of year because it's just hazy.
I think they're fairly equal in terms of times of years to go. I think if you're going to go to in as well, but I say there's been great flights both times, both of those times. And last time I was out there the year before, I had that classic high pressure, and it was like that when I started, and it was like that soon after I left as well. It's just that period of time just hit instability, really. Western Nepal is probably a little bit better in February than it is in October. Being solo, that was quite something, I think, really. It'd been quite nice to go with someone else, but I always look at the positives of going solo. even if you need to find out one small takeoff to take off from. You haven't got to consider landing when someone else has landed or pull them down to land with you. I had a better interaction with the locals, I think, by being solo. You sort of immersed straight into a family. They very much absorb, you know, one person in very quickly, I think. There's obviously disadvantages in terms of safety, it's probably the biggest one, being by yourself. And decision making, possibly, and finding fennels. I mean, finding fennels, there's so many vultures out there, and actually they do it for you, really. Water was quite a challenge. I used to carry 3 litres a day. You get through like a, for cooking, drinking, and everything else, you need 3 litres a day. So it's how you top up throughout the day, because you end up landing and you've drunk the water, you've had your breakfast, you've drunk some water in your flights, you've now landed, you're now down to half a litre. Well, you're going to cook tonight, you need water, if you want water to take off, you're going to go up the mountain to take off the next day, you need water before you take off. So I was kind of camelback, and I had one of their plastic disposable bottles, mostly full of water. And a water filter to sort of top it up when I needed to. But it was a kind of a planning thing all the time. That charging batteries and water were the two things in my mind that I had to sort of be on the game with. Charge batteries and find water. And the health and exhaustion, conscious of trying to eat well. So I took enough food for 7 days, as in terms of packaged food, and I bought en route, so I bought noodles and ate with amazing. And I had left food in Pokhara as well, so the idea was to get to Pokhara and then carry on further east. But so food wasn't such an issue. It was trying to avoid dodgy food, really, because obviously the only dodgy food I really had was roadside food, which I shouldn't have, but it was just at that point the most convenient thing I could have had in the middle of nowhere. There was you get these buses and they stop. There's no service stations, obviously, but they have a regular stop where they basically everyone piles off and goes to get to Dal Bar in this little hut. But this, and it was just fine normally. So you can choose and pick and it tastes good, you can eat it. But there's one particular stop I had, all they had was some momos with some meat in it. I don't know what it was, but it was bad. And that knocked me back for 2 days. And then that, obviously, you know, fortunately the first day was, it was bad, it was raining, so I was able to stay put. And I was also fortunate to be in a hotel. But I had to keep moving on, so I was conscious of that. So the next day I was like, up, I'm going, still having the shit. And that kind of set the scene then for the start of the exhaustion going forward, because I never really quite got over that that backlog, really. But those are the main challenges of the whole thing. But yeah, so it's 21 days of, yeah.
I think from the film point of view, the thing that I've talked to other producers about and who we get across in the film, why I sort of changed the title of it to Tosh's Nepal Traverse Diary, is that it's the solo thing. I think it's hopefully what comes across, and if it doesn't, I've failed, but what comes across is it's like Ellen MacArthur going across the Atlantic on her own. I mean, Tosh goes into villages and meets people, but all of the tricky stuff is completely solo. So being up in the mountains, the flying, the getting the water, everything is totally, there's no getter. At best, he's got his inReach and saying, I've crashed 4 days from civilization. Can you send a hospital? I'll see if I can stay alive for 4 days till it gets here. You know, that was the level at which he was doing it, which I hadn't appreciated at all until I watched the rushes do. So I really hope that comes across, because to me, it blew me away, because I thought, you saw that list of people who have done it, and there's some great films, the Blutch one, where, but they've actually got support crews, because they must have, because there's film of them flying across the mountain, so somebody must have been filming them. So there's a camera crew there, at the very least there's a camera crew there, and they've got helicopter shots, and there's a helicopter there that could pick them up and take them to safety if they needed to be evacuated. But Tosh actually really did do it all on his own, and that's why I suddenly thought, well, this is kind of worthy. From a film point of view, it just being GoPro footage, because if it's anything else, it's not real. It's not just his adventure, not just his diary of this is me leaving home and here I am going through the Himalayas, which I thought was made it unique, really, and hopefully, I'm not claiming it will succeeded, but hopefully that's what comes across, is that, you know, you're your Jack Jones out there, which is quite a big deal. It's quite a big deal if you went around the Black Mountains on your own.
Yeah.
The Himalayas, it's extraordinary.
Yeah.
So, kit, 27 kilos, that's including everything I was wearing, that's bulk my body. and quite a bit of food in there. So that's the sort of the breakdown of it. The list is quite long, actually, you get down to this, you'll see. I took things like spare lines and patches, the glider.
What are the colours, do you know?
So yeah, you can't quite see it. So camping, so that's all cooking. There's tents, there's food, there's cooking facilities, not food. Board and that sort of stuff. This is clothes. Famously took one pair of pants. Two pairs of socks, one pair of pants. So you go for the pants which dry really quickly, and so that's, you can dry them overnight if you want. Two pairs of socks, you walk through water, you need to be able to dry them off. But that's all the clothes, everything bit of clothing I was wearing. So an amazing Rab Infinity Down jacket, which is superb. That's been sponsored from Trek, so I was able to go out and splurge a little bit on some stuff. Some good discounts there. A couple of base layers and some after-job from trousers. I took handbags.
Just reminding them that they're upstairs.
I wore handbag boots. I mean, it's the sort of terrain you're on. I think it's, you do it on this, but I think, you know, I like handbags. I can walk for those miles. You know, the super lightweight, and there's some protection there. And I think I was more at risk of twisting my ankle walking than I was landing most of the time. But you know, they gave me support. They've got a cushion sole, which is quite key, I think, as well. Electronics, the basics electronics. That's the power bank, the chargers. I took a fly master because I had the time. In reach, mobile phone.
Did you have a solar charger or something?
Yeah, I had a solar charger, anchor solar charger. Which I had out on the harness a couple of times and on the backpack, and every time I stopped camping, I had it out.
It's
good.
It did well.
Yeah, I probably four times I ended up, or five times I ended up somewhere, someone's house, and then charged it off their thing. But a lot of times I was staying at a hotel, and if I was staying in the house there, they're only using solar anyway, so it was actually quite a slow process. And it's like, you know, you can't watch television tonight, I'm gonna plug this into your solar battery. And cameras and that as well. Yeah, so I had GoPro and the digital SLR and batteries, and so it's quite a few years of weight in there, quite a bit. So this wing harness and all the associated equipment with flying. So Alpina 2, Nepal Alpina 2, super harness. What's in there else in that? Big gloves will be in that as well. Food and water, that's all that's really the water. So as freaky as that is actually water. So it's not a lot of food in there. Cliff bars didn't last long enough. Those miscellaneous is stuff, ever little stuff like a lightweight bag and that sort of thing, and poles and things. But this is actually quite long, you see, but it actually looks less. If it didn't hit the table, it stayed.
Or a violin.
I guess that's, you know, I always think it was like 22 kilos my bag, I think, most of the time, was somewhere around there at the beginning. Got a little bit light, a bit of food and stuff. Self-sufficient really, it's quite good. That's my last slide. Mm-hmm. Open for questions. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Question
time. Thank you very much. Did you say your first VolBiv?
Was a year before.
Before.
Yeah, the one I did out of Pokhara going east.
Didn't think to practice before, or
no. And actually,
my bride's gonna be next year.
It's it was quite ballsy actually, to be fair. That, and I had I did, you know, where I landed that third night was just epic. It was right up, and you know, it lulled me to a false sense of the whole process, really. But yeah, it was great. But I think, yeah, being popular for 2 weeks before that, so I felt fine, really. And I knew it's not going to find a landing field somewhere, it'd be alright. But if you go over the back of the green, go up the green wall, ridge behind the green wall, and then go east, that next valley is quite committing. There's no landing, I haven't seen any landings in it, and so to go to the next ridge again, get round the next spur, and then it sort of opens up a bit more, so it gets a bit better.
And you had no like big mountain experience as such?
Alps, no, far from that.
He's a high mountain guy,
yeah,
like profession.
Yeah, no, I hadn't, no. I think if one thing I would have put into this would have been use the classic sort of thing, you have a bit of dental floss, so actually if somebody gets stuck in the tree, you can let it down, pull the rope up. But the problem is they harvest wood off every tree in Nepal, so every tree is like a telegraph pole, and so they can't reach it, and it's like got a canopy in it. So if you end up in the tree, that's great, but you're going to break your legs getting to the last bit. So actually, what we'll take next time will be a lightweight rope and some simple scram system. So actually, I can then get from that last, you know, two head heights up down to the ground. That's the important bit really, that hurts.
You mentioned the weather obviously being important. How are you forecasting? How are you getting information about the weather? We were just looking at
Ali Andrews. I was messaging him on InReach to get updates just on, you know, stability, and that's the key element of it really. And then when I was getting signals using Windy. Yeah, Windy was the best really for anything out there. Nothing else seemed to have any sense of weather data really. With Windy, the key elements to me was the stability, so you can get a skew off it and get an idea of altitude for cloud base and wind. And cloud cover, I suppose.
You mentioned on the camera angles on there, which ones did you use? What did you use?
I had a pole, I had a bracket, I had a little tripod thing, a little bracket, which must be in there somewhere, which sits onto your carabiner, which is quite a handy thing, to that angle.
That's quite key. So you actually showed me that. I bought two of those after you showed it to me. They worked really well. That is designed for poles and for hang gliders, but it still works on your risers. And it's a kind of rubber bracket with a monopod type mount on it, with a mount on it that you can screw the camera onto. And that's just, I experimented for ages with trying to get, because I was flying with birds of prey, and I was trying to get the second person point of view of me with the birds of prey. And if you put the monopod out, which is the classic, you know, everybody's the cross-country magazine cover, and then you airbrush out the actual pole. But that's a nightmare to take off with. And if you were to get in trouble, if you had a big collapse, that's not going to be great either. And it's in your way, and you only see the bit of footage that they want you to see. 95% of it, the camera's flipped upside down, or it's not quite right, or it moves around, and it's all over the place. So that little amount, just having it here, it's not the greatest shot, but it's a shot that's completely reliable, and you don't have to think about it. It's a dash cam, basically. You forget it's there, just press record and carry on flying. And then you get all the bits where you're gurning and talking to yourself.
And the worst thing is I want to go for it, so it's like I decide when I was taking off, am I going to put my head and film, you know, the great launch and the landing and that sort of thing, and nothing of me, or am I going to, you know, try and get a third person perspective and a bit more of me? I'm not enamored by the 360. I've got a 360 camera, but I think it's I just don't really like the footage for something like we were doing.
No, it's actually very low resolution. It works great on YouTube.
Because I've tried a couple of different mounts myself, on the lines just above, obviously on the risers, on the lines. This is quite good.
The trouble with any of those things is, in his situation, is that they had to be quite reactive. So you may well. This one here is also, we didn't mention, it swivels. So the good thing about having it is you can have it looking at you, and then if something epic is happening in front of you, there's a vulture sitting right on your feet, you just go turn it around and leave it there. So it's very quick. So even if you're in really strong conditions, I'm a complete wuss. So if I'm in really strong conditions, I find it really hard to let go of the controls to move the camera around. But sometimes that's absolutely necessary. And you definitely don't want the whole flight done on one angle. So if you've got a mount that A is completely hands-free, I think we both agreed it's pretty safe, it's out of the way of, it's very, very unlikely that the wing is going to collapse and a line's going to come right down to your shoulder. But also it's versatile, so you could stick it out the side, you can look at the ground, you can look at you, or you can look dead ahead with a very simple movement. You don't want to do anything, it just clicks around, and so that works really well.
Yeah, because I've done one at the end of your on your pod, mounted it on the end there, so you can turn it around facing forward and facing you, which is quite good.
I think that works really well. Yeah, the trouble with that one is it's always looking up, and of course the epic scenery is down there. So it works fine when you turn it around, And you never get you and the scenery, you get you and the wing and the sky. Whereas that one, you get both. You get that wingtip, you can see the clouds, and you can also see the mountains down here, and then Tosh is in the foreground. So.
And there won't be that without missing in the first, it's just that third person perspective of the glider traveling across from someone else's glider. That is the one thing which is obviously recognised to be lacking. But apart from actually having someone with a drone or a helicopter, you can't really get around that really.
Conditions are too dodgy to have the one tree in
there. Yeah, and I looked at putting in the canopy as well, but again, some of the takeoffs, you sort of, yeah, just happy the wind comes up. The last thing I want is.
And again, that trail cam thing behind you, it's massively edited. So I've got one and I've used it, and it looks great. I've done little videos together, but it's 6 hours of footage and 25 seconds on YouTube. Which is just not good enough if you're an adventure like that. It's fine as an also. It's the same that, you know, the classic one where you put it right up and the line's looking down. Absolutely brilliant for a whole 3 seconds.
Yeah.
4 seconds in broad shin, isn't it? So, you know, a 6 hour flight, it's not really going to work. So I think, you know, you want to see, in my opinion, you want to see what the pilot's thinking as well as where he is and what's going on. So you need that versatility of being able to move it around. In sometimes what can be really challenging conditions. You don't want to go, well, I couldn't move the camera because it was the air was too snotty. But if all you've got to do is go, now, okay, I've got it, carry on flying, then it's that sort of work. So that a lot, I think a lot of that comes from me being such a wuss, because I used to design mounts that were, originally I had like a cramp on that was on my foot and the camera was up here. But you take off and then you kick the camera as you take off and it's pointing in the wrong direction. And if it's the days that I always want to do it were on the strong thermic cross-country days, then I never had the bravery to let go of the controls and try and get the camera right. So it was Tosh who came up with it first, and then I sort of played with it and went, well, this really works because you can adjust it in the air. It's sort of like your sat nav when you're driving. It's not full on let go of the steering wheel, and you can just go carry on driving, you know, it's the same sort of deal, so I think it works rather well.
Yeah, I've done the ones, the old boot mount, the GoPro on my boot, done the mount for that, so it's on your foot. So if you're sat in front of you, and obviously you can just lift your foot higher if you want the background,
yeah,
you know, if something's coming up.
But it does, I've done it, and it's very easy to damage it on landing and takeoff, and then you're screwed, you know, which is great if you're here. Just go back to the car and get another one out of the boot, but not if you're in your hall. That's your only camera.
Yeah.
You know, if it gets kicked, it's game over.
With DSLR, how much of the film you use on that is on this, the final product, or none at all?
Yeah, it's quite a bit. Lot. Yeah, I'm actually, well, like
as stills.
No. And what I liked about it is actually it has that sort of that focusing. Definition where you actually have, you know, the background's like blurred and it's focused on you and it's
a shallow depth of field, for instance.
So did you use that when you were flying? Yes, yeah. When you were flying.
No. I tried to use that as much as I could in the ground. Really.
Yeah.
So it's some of Tosh's stuff where he's gone into a village and he's just looking around and he's filming the kids and stuff and stuff like that, and it's much more cinematic.
Yeah.
It also, from a technical point of view, it reflects the human eye. So the reason in cinema you see the background so blurred is if I'm looking at you, there's no way I can see him in focus. No human on earth can, but a GoPro can.
Yeah.
So it looks like video.
Yeah.
Whereas film, which is your tradition you look at, is you get the depth of field that the human eye gets, which so it does two things. One is it seems natural, but two is it focuses all your attention on the thing you're pointing at, not the stuff in the background.
Yeah.
Whereas a GoPro just gets everything because it's one lens trying to get the viewpoint of two eyes. If you had two DSLRs side by side, then you'd get the human viewpoint. But the GoPro is using a wide angle lens because I can see what from there to there. Well, the only way you can do that on a camera is to see from there to there as well. And it's all going to be in focus. And that is going to look like it's 10 miles away. It's the, you know, the joy of a wide angle. But you never see that in real life because you've got two, technically speaking, 50mm lenses, side by side, so your vision is twice as wide as it is high, and it's got, in cinema terms, the 50 millimeter lens you'd have on a 35 millimeter camera is about the same perspective as a human eye. The GoPro, not at all. The GoPro is something like an 8 millimeter lens, so it's really, really fisheye, which is great for epic scenery, but terrible if you're trying to put across, I'm looking at this little kid sitting down here picking his nose, because you can also do the chicken off to his left and the thing off to the right, you know, and it's distracting. So the DSLR works very, very well for that.
So where are you with the film then at the moment? What stage is that?
Pretty close now, aren't we?
Yeah.
It's been quite an organic process for this for Lightroom, isn't it? I've started it again just now. That's the third iteration. Well, we just about lockdown. Just went, do you know what? We've got all the time in the world. It's just been that and start again. It's got to the limit of our joint computing power now. We can't do so many more changes because we don't have the computer. But basically, the story's down, all the pictures are in, the music's, we've got very, very, thankfully we had a composer do the music for us. And so we've got to the stage now where we've sort of looked at, so what haven't we got? What isn't explained by the pictures, by the diary, and by the interviews? And those bits are now going to be, we're going to use the diary motif, so it'll actually be Tosh reading his actual diary, which is what I kind of based the edit on. And we don't want to you don't want to read it, so he'll read it as a voiceover. You'll see the page of the diary, and that'll just use it as a kind of a bookend, if that makes sense, or a chapter heading. So it's like day five, I'm beginning to feel a bit crap now. I hope I can get to so and so, and then it might well say, I started to walk up the hill and blah, 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 blah. So it's just kind of setting the scene each time. So we've got to record those bits. And then I had an attempt at doing graphics. I had this wonderful idea that we've got some, Josh took some shots of himself writing his diary. And I thought, well, we've got to put maps in. And I looked at all the way everybody else had done their maps. I said, oh, it kind of doesn't really fit with what we're doing because it's all very immediate and it's just first person. So I had this idea that the map could be Tosh's doodle. So just like he got that map, was looking at it, and he just drawn it out in biro, and then he was just drawing in where he'd got. And then I thought a bit further, and I thought we could do a little animated cartoon, as if he'd made a little mini Tosh. And then I thought, oh, but it could be in the Nepali, traditional Nepali art style. So we did that, and then it would look like it was sort of animated going through the map, which is way out of my league. Well, I'd let it go anyway. It's sort of.
Yeah, it's great, but it actually just. It's great, but he's doing a lot of greatness.
There's a lot of it to do. So we're going to probably take that to an animator and say that there's all they call it the elements, which is the expensive bit. Just make it go from there to there, please. And they'll just put all these little dots on, and it'll follow the path that they put in. So we've got record voiceover, do those bits of graphics, and then we've got to do the what in Teleworld is called making it legal, which is making sure that all the sound doesn't distort, that the whites aren't blown out, is what we say, so that the bits that are overexposed aren't so overexposed. In the old days, if you did that on a cathode ray television, the television would stop working. Mm-hmm. That's why they call it legal. So they weren't allowed to put those pictures out because it would burn the tube out on the television. Mm-hmm. But now it's just horrible, just as this big slab of white looks awful. Mm-hmm. So it's all just technical stuff, basically, and I'm not that person, so we're going to take it to somebody that does that stuff and just sits there and goes through it frame by frame and adjusts everything so it's all neat. A bit like you would on a music recording. So, you know, what's recorded live in the studio then goes to a producer who mixes it with the term you'd hear. So we've got to mix the sound and then grade the film footage. So we're pretty close, aren't we, really? Pretty damn close.
Ask you about the solo aspect of it, of
I'm just quite intriguing. Like, did you do any preparation before, like psychologically to me? I mean, I lose my phone signal, I start having a panic attack, so that to me is like yeah. crazy. And then moving on from that, any preparation that you did, like, you know, you said about the trees and that, how did you cope with that aspect of the adventure?
I think I'm, for me as a character, I think it depends on your character to a lot and how you take risk and how you sort of take chances. I mean, you know, I've been in my own business for a while, and that sort of person, I sort of like, you know, it's for me, it's about, I'm quite comfortable in sort of driving my own route forward. I was very conscious of the aspect of survival, I think. More so once I'd started, perhaps, than beforehand. Although, you know, my diary entry is quite poignant when I leave. I did put my house in order before I left. You know, I sorted a lot of shit out before I left, you know, wills and all that sort of stuff. Because, you know, there's a risk element to this sort of trip.
So you didn't go into it completely?
No, I didn't, no. And, you know, everything, I had all the insurances in place. You know, I sorted out wills, I sorted out all the affairs at home. You know, I wasn't going to go and leave a baggage behind, yeah. So that kind of covered everything off. And I think at the point of leaving, it was a case of actually, when I said goodbye to my wife, it was actually quite, okay, this is quite an element of risk here. And you can't get away from that because, you know, shit happens when you paraglide, doesn't it? I'm very much aware that actually where I was going to go, there wasn't going to be an immediate response. So, you know, again, it was about in reach, it was about understanding which service you wanted to sort out, that actually if I was being tracked and I wasn't responding, they needed to be able to raise the Go Global rescue for me, as opposed to having to rely on a Garmin one, which relies on you pressing the rescue button. So it's that sort of stuff was taken into account. I didn't go into it blind. I knew the risks, but I was quite comfortable with looking after myself, really. Yeah, I'm an outdoor. I've been an outdoor person all my life. I was born from the farm. I've been out there, you know, doing it. Doing pretty rad stuff all my life, really. But this is not as bad as this, that's for sure.
And how did you sort of cope, sort of midway through? Was there any sort of low points? Because bounce off. How it comes over, you haven't just got something to bounce off a lot of the time.
Yeah.
Go, oh, you know, I'm feeling a bit. So, you know, how did you cope with all
that? It was. Quite poignant at a certain point in the film where actually it's been captured in the film quite well, I think. There was a certain point in that whole journey where you could have just done a buddy alongside just to keep you going, because actually you're trying to keep motivated. You're in a position in the mountains where you can't go, okay, time out, I've had it. You've got to keep going, because actually there's no getting out of there. Yeah, there's snow on the ground, there's no transport about. You either fly, you walk, you go, keep going. And so at that point you are at your lowest point, and there's no sort of, you just gotta keep going, really. But what I did, I come back to it, is actually I'm only an ordinary bloke doing this, and what I did was actually it wasn't mega, it's not, I'm not gonna kind of big this up, it was just, you know, it was what it was. It's not some sort of epic high alpine glacial thing. It's actually, I was. If I had an accent, the first person that I would come across me would be a local, in that scenario. I'm not in the middle of nowhere completely. But I'm a long way from Western, from the Western world. I saw one helicopter in the process of being out there. That was the only other aircraft I saw. I think you probably had more of a shot to see me. I was in the middle of nowhere. He came across over this mountain top, and he went right round me, going, "What the fuck's this?" Carried on.
I think we tried to get, or I tried to get across the fact that, I don't know, funny kind of way as well, because I know Tosh is a friend, but you, without being rude, you're not a radical dude. You're not some crazy dope smoking guy who surfs in the winter and paraglides in the summer and goes up Everest. You're a businessman who went on that. So, making it more everyman, I think it makes it more approachable for the audience, is my thinking. It's very easy to, like, base jumping would be a classic example where you go, well, like, vast majority of the planet will go, well, they've got to be completely insane to ever even think about doing that. So to take it to a more insane level, and you know, when the Red Bull stunt is that they're going to fly from this tiny little gap, you go, well, they're all completely mental anyway, so you can't get any more mental than completely mental. And I didn't want to do that. I didn't want it to come across like that. And I'll be honest and say, from my early films, I did. So I really liked those guys that I met, and I go, well, they're all radical dudes, and I was trying to get that across and sort of be it. But it just alienates 95% of the audience. You know, the adventure sports world loves those people. The rest of the world thinks they're nutters. So I wanted to get across the point that Tosh is A, not stupid, and B, not like insane risk taker who's going to make it to be 27. You know, he's got it past that already.
Were you ever scared?
There were moments, I think it was the scary moments were, when the scary moments, few least side moments, and there was a couple of times I was in a valley when it wasn't really working very well, and you're sort of, there's no landing options, you're just trees and rivers and rocks, and so I'm not necessarily scared at that point, you're just on high adrenaline, working every ounce of lift, and actually ironically it ends up, seems to work, you sort of just keep going at it and eventually get out. So those are the sort of moments. But I think there was probably, and there was another, the scariest moment I had, it was on a muzzy car. I walked up, it was a long walk up, I was there a bit late. So quite a strong wind was coming from the west. I was facing the sun on the south side, and it just, so I was hoping to take off around this corner and it wasn't working. It was very rocky, really lots of little bushes, very hard to get a glider up, and it wasn't, the wind was off on the side. So I went round to this one spot, and it was literally, that would have been the space I had, with rocks behind, and I was literally on the edge of quite a big drop, and I had these two butterflies land on both hands, one on each hand, and I thought, well, good sign, bad sign. I managed to get off, and I instantly had a collapse, which you sort of go, okay, I've got to sort that out. Another collapse, and sort of 30-40% of the wing went, and it just went, the whole sky went ballistic, you know, it's just like, and so I ended up spiraling down to land, getting to about landing, and going back up again. So it's that classic scenario of not being able to get down, the sky's kicking off, and I was landing, trying to land in the village, it wasn't in the middle of nowhere, but it's just that sort of moment of actually shit. And then this is when you don't want a crowd of people, isn't it? So eventually get down, and I land, and all you want to do is go, oh, I'm down, and people come running around and thinking, fuck off. I didn't film that, it was just completely stressed out. So actually, you're sort of trying to reply, and that, it's just thinking shit out as well. And that's actually where you want to make, because actually you want to go, what fault was that?
So both those incidents that you particularly recalled were flight related. It wasn't actually about managing on the ground or feeding yourself or tracking. It was the actual thing that caused that.
The people, everything else was fine. And even, sleeping out of a tent in the mountain, and you can hear whatever came here, I heard wolves and so that sort of stuff. That doesn't spin out. I had one night where actually I was in a tent, and I could hear these people. You occasionally hear them, and like they got louder and louder and louder. And I saw lights, they got louder and louder. And basically, I unzipped my tent, and I was like you guys outside my tent, just sitting there. Got the old jet boil out and a cup of tea, it was just like, just going to see what this tent was on top of the mountain, and it's just all walked up from the village.
Do you think you could have done without a tent? Because we hear people wrapping themselves in their wig and all that sort of thing.
I need a better tent than that one. Yeah, I needed that. That was too drafty for me, really. I'm looking at tents now for the next trip out, because I just could do a four season tent.
Yes, virtually.
Amazing sleeping bag, which was, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so it wasn't cheap, was it?
No.
So if you've got, so the film's nearly finished, there is a time scale for that, and then you talked about the charity, or a little bit, you touched on the charities and the fundraising.
So the idea is this film, and if there's another film, the idea is that my income from it is going to two charities, so it's the Canali River Trust and to the Karma Free Flight. And so that's my way of sort of saying thank you and raising it, so that the credits get the film to that. And the way it's working is that we're raising money to make the film, and then and Martin's getting paid for, well, I'm paid now, and we're paying the sort of like the people to do the sort of the soundtrack and that sort of stuff to do that, which is, you know, a serious budget really. And we've had the sound score done for a few hundred quid.
Yeah,
and that's the whole sound score for the whole thing, you know, bespoke.
Orchestrated
sound score for it, amazing. So actually, rather than you make a YouTube clip of Frank comes to the film, Frank listens to the music, but we wait. Martin gave her the film and goes right, and she basically has written the score to the music.
So that's, so what's going on is this, it's a scene with Jeopardy in it, and not only is the music, I went to see her doing it, and I'm an amateur musician, and she said, well, obviously this needs to be a minor sixth here, because if we're saying to her, definitely a minor sixth, and this is an augmented ninth. But an augmented ninth here to minor sixth would work perfectly, because that would say, I'm lost, but I'm not that lost. And she's giving me these chords, I go, oh yeah, and it does. It's really interesting.
So it's exactly the same type of music. So it's
she sort of combined class, she's classically trained flautist, but she knows loads about classical music, and she's using that knowledge. And then she's added sounds, the Nepali type sounds to it, but it's still this clever kind of musical language to go, this is Jeopardy, this is Joy, this is...
Galloping Trolls.
Yeah, exactly. Whatever it is, but she's put the music, and then as Tosh said, having got the individual scores, she said, then well, now send me the clip, and then she recuts it, rewrites it, times it to actually fit the picture, so we don't fit the picture to the music, she fits the music to the pictures, which is, I've never had that before, it's a luxury.
So yeah, so we're raising money to make the film, and then the money that we hope to make is a paid preview film, and so the income that I would normally receive from the film is going to go to charity. That's the idea. And we'll do, I'll take it on tour, and we'll submit it to film festivals, hopefully get a few laurels for it. Obviously missed the ones this year, so in for next year, Martin.
I know. Real life went away,
didn't it? So that's the idea. So I hope it has a bit of legacy, really, and to sort of pay back to Nepal at the end of it.
And will there be a second film?
Yes, hopefully. I'm going to go back out anyway. I've got unfinished business here. I had originally come back. Yeah, got to Pokhara and thought, right, I'm come back and carry on from Pokhara, but actually West Nepal is so amazing, I'm going to go back and start again.
Oh really?
Yeah.
And one of the interesting things about TV commissioners, especially, I don't know so much about film commissioners, but oddly, given the industry they're in, they have zero imagination. So you have to show them what you're talking about. You know, I could talk to you about it and you go, oh, that sounds amazing. I can get the money, we'll get to. They go, what? And they fake that, but they're incredibly cynical. So they assume that you must be talking nonsense, you couldn't do it. So one of the things that might just come out of this is that when we finish this film, we'll take it to the film festivals, and that puts it under the nose of the people with the money, and they'll go, God, if you'd had a helicopter there, that would have been great. We'd go, yeah, give us the money, honey. Mm-hmm. And helicopters in the second, you know, and then
just the drone.
The idea with them was I would go back out with Tosh and with maybe a couple of other crew, and we would follow the adventure and try and capture bits. So it wouldn't have the unique, completely solo thing. But I think we would still try and keep it very hands off, trying to do it from afar. But I think the eye candy of the glider against the scenery is and the way I look at it is a reward for the audience. So, you know, films are made like that. It's the chorus in a pop song is that, you know, you listen to the verse and then they reward you with a nice catchy in chorus, and then you get the middle eight. And films are done pretty much the same way. So that's the theory. So, but they, that costs a lot of money, huge amount of money.
So you can find a trailer.
Once you start doing it all legally, it goes up exponentially. You do it guerrilla style, it's expensive. Once you do it where everybody's insured and you've got all the permits and stuff, it's 50 times the cost. By the way, can I just point out, I don't normally dress in black like Johnny Cash. I just come from a film shoot where you had to wear black. Mm-hmm. I suddenly realised, I'm neither the waiter nor a Johnny Cash impressionist. That's my job.
I was just going to say, like, the trailer here, but no, I've got the trailer.
The other screen's giving it a power.
Yeah, I've just taken it off.
One on Vimeo. Somewhere.
Yeah, the internet here is really.
Oh, well,
has everyone watched the trailer for the and good plays? Internet doesn't look very promising.
The connection to this route is okay, but it's that actual internet connection.
Well, we can always put the link to the trailer on Telegram.
Yeah.
And watch it.
Well, if the trailer plays, that's great. If not, we can look it afterwards. But I'd like to say thank you very much to both of you for. You managed to floor us for 2 hours, which is very amazing adventure and really interesting to hear about the filmmaking aspect of it.
Yeah, I think it's a good angle to have.
Yeah, really, really, really good to hear. Thank you very much.
Pleasure.
Is that a good one?